has not been. Thank you.
Psychological. You guys, if you want to answer Caesar, you know, Tiberius, Corey, that's fine. If you want to answer as yourselves, that's fine. Whatever's most comfortable for y'all. Okay, look, my questions are first person, so they will be for your characters, but whatever you want to do with regard to that. Okay. Jenna, you were standing obediently, eyes downcast. Crassus refused his wife, saying, Corey shall come to my knees. The look she gave you when he said that, the look in your own in response, how were you able to just kind of cope as he blatantly denied his wife's intentions, making it clear he preferred yours?
Pretty well, I guess. I guess it was pretty acceptable. That's the whole idea, that it was acceptable.
Yeah, there we go. There we go. To the mouth.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, that's my children, right? This is gonna get real dirty.
I guess it was, yeah, just to answer that, was, I guess it was accepted, that was the way of the world, that you were married, but you also, you know, you had, he slept around, he had favorite servants, he had his pet. I think the problem was, is that before Corey, I guess there wasn't a particular slave that stuck. And this was more than just a regular master-slave sort of relationship in a way. It became more about love, and that's why his wife was threatened. That's, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Christian, my questions are kind of long, so I'm going to hear. Okay, so every day for months, he wrestles with the man, groans and grunts, filling air, and I forced to stand witness to the lessons while more pressing matters fall to the lessons. Disdain clouded your eyes as you sat in baneful obedience, watching your father train with Polaris. And when you risk giving voice to your feelings, you waste time sparring with a common slave. I believe we tower above a slave in all things. You found yourself speared by a taunting challenge. Often heard to say my intent lies only in honor and title earned, your father smirked when he fell, walking away from your bleeding humiliation, that lesson sorely needed. Ever striving to shine in your father's eyes, you discovered them closed to all but your imperfections. My lessons never cease, it is for him to apply them. Lessons, Tiberius, always lessons rather than warmth and affection. You later lamented to Corey, I don't understand, to which she replied, set aside wounded pride and see shrouded mystery parted. By what utilization of strategy and discerning mind were you able to survive the demands of growing up with a sire who constantly forced you to earn the title of son, while more pressing matters fell to your attention?
That was a beautifully poetical recap of the first six episodes. Thank you.
Question.
I was so enthralled in the story.
Alright, so how'd you do it? I mean, your father was like, you yeah. always have to be this perfect example of a son. Mm. And yet, you were never able to live up to his expectations, right? Mm-hmm. So how did you like feel with him? You know, he was always making you prove yourself or doing other things while you wanted his attention, you know?
Yes.
So how did you feel with that? What was it like growing up with that?
It's such a universal kind of story, I think. Something that a lot of people probably relate to. But yeah, to strive for that attention, but to not get it, trying to constantly do what your father tells you to do, it's difficult for, especially in those days as well, because it was so much more structured and rigid and to follow certain rules. But there was something that was burning inside of him, and Crassus had the structure laid out for his son, but at the same time, without realizing, I think Crassus had also lit a little flame inside of his son that was burning for, and that burn was for desire to have that power. Little did he know that, you know, it's always, it's not really the, I've found also, it's not really, just reading, it's not really what you say to people, it's what you do. You know, I mean, you can give someone advice, but if you're not living that advice, I don't think it's I don't think it'll be as strong as a whole. But so Crassus would be, you know, giving me certain advice, but then he'd be going off and being the most powerful person in the world. So what I would take is what he was doing rather than what he was saying. So although he's laying these foundations for me, I wanted to be where he was, because he was idol. Oh, he was an idol. He was a father, but he was an idol. So, you know, it was difficult to do. And I was tested. There were certain wolves that came at the gate. I tested that. And there are those little moments where, as a young teenager, as a, you know, growing into a man, they're the lessons that define you and how you go about that. You know, you can hide from the adversity, or you can face it, and he faced it. And on the other side was the growth, you know. And I found it interesting because as a bad guy, you know, in a cliche sense, Tiberius was, you know, a dick. But, you know, I tried to find it so that, you know, at the end of the day, everyone that does what they do it for a reason, and their reason to themselves is validated, and they know, they believe that they're right. So I wanted to persuade the audience and kind of influence them to see a side of his character that, although it was terrible, he was doing these terrible things, that if there was 2% of your psyche that could go, I do get what he's doing though, then that was the mission that the writers had instilled for us. And that, you know, I guess that's 5-minute version of me getting to my answer.
Thank you. Alright, so Caesar, you were not present when Crassus enacted decimation. So what were your thoughts in regard to the Imperator's decision to return to this putrid specter? Must have surprised or instilled fear or birthed your rage? What impact did it have upon your decision and behavior thereafter?
I think it kind of fueled him more, to be honest, because the way that I approached Caesar was, first of all, I found this lineage that he was tracked back to the bloodline of Zeus. So my approach to that was he was basically immortal in his own mindset. So I figured if I go into a character and he believes that he comes from an immortal bloodline, what sort of power would that instill in you? Like, it's almost hard to fathom, but I think I had to, you know, source some sort of energy from a higher level. So going into that deposition stuff, he was all about title. I think that was the interesting part to play with Caesar, the ego that he had. I think that was what I enjoyed playing with him so much, because he was, that ego and that bravado was so present in most of the scenes, but I think he just wanted to be accepted by his father figure, which was Crassus. And I think that particular moment where Tiberius gained that title, that was kind of his biggest blow, because he was all about title. Title meant everything back then, and that gave him his position, which ultimately obviously led to his power politically. So I think that just fueled him more. Fueled, obviously, our hatred as well, because it was all about title. And he felt Tiberius was given the title through lineage instead of earning the title. So he then was fueled even further to prove himself in battle, prove himself in the military stance. And that's what I learned as well, that Caesar in history proved himself in battle and proved himself as a general to the point where he earned basically the highest regard that the military offered, which then led to him leading into his political power, which is why he became so powerful. So that's kind of what I grabbed little elements that I've discovered myself, and then other personality traits, and then the real history to, like, kind of build why he was doing it. Because you have to justify, like Christian said, everyone has a justification for doing everything. Even if you're a serial killer, there's a reason why you're a serial killer. You're a serial killer because you know, perhaps there was some kind of abuse or emotionally, physically when you're growing up, which altered elements of your brain, which caused you to be a certain way. Like, we don't just wake up and say, I'm going to be like that. So you have to justify it. Even if he's a dick, or if he's a serial killer, or if he's a, you know, Caesar. You have to justify the actions. You can't judge your own character. If you judge your own character, then you're not gonna embody him properly. You just have to accept his justification for it and then go for it. Yeah.
Hey, Jenna. Alright, when Crassus offered to take you to Rome, he seduced you with romantic words. I do not pose question as master, but as man, and would have answered as one. In the academy, you said to him, we have taken to each other's arms many times, you've never soared so high. To which he responded, we are far from Rome, and tethers that prevent such flight. What meaning did that statement hold for you? Did you feel he truly loved you, or were you just a convenience? Did you love him, or was it willing obedience?
I think that's sort of what I was really trying to discover throughout the whole season, which is, I mean, you watch the show and it's all about slaves and their masters and what the masters do with their slaves. And you know, the whole season one with Lucy and Crixus, and how she thinks she sort of almost, she thinks she's in love with him in a way, and to him, and he's in love with Nadia, and it's that whole big thing. So in my mind, it's going, well, she's a slave. This is how she was raised. So is it sort of Stockholm syndrome in a way? Like, what is it like? Are they really in love? And that was something I sort of had to really think about and work through. And I truly believe, because the way Simon portrayed Crassus was such that, you know, he was not a man that would really waste his time if it wasn't real. You know what I mean? So I really do think he did love her because of the way, like, he could have anything in the world that he wanted, but he chose this. And it wasn't because of power, and it wasn't because of this, because he already had all those things. It didn't, you know, he didn't need to sort of do that. So, wow, I'm like, where have I gone?
It's okay, wondering's good.
Yeah, no, I just think with Kore, I think in her mind, she truly did love him, and that's why she does, that's why she leaves him, because all of this awful thing that's happened to her. And I think, you know, throughout the story, she, at the beginning of the story, she, you know, she just loves these two men. She loves, you know, one is sort of like a, you know, someone that she looks after, like a brother sort of thing. And then the other one, she loves both of them. And she just wants the best for them. And they just keep getting themselves, like, every piece of advice she gives either one of them, they go, I'm going to do the opposite. And, you know, and it's kind of like, you know, they should have just listened to her. That's all I have to say. But I think that's why she sort of had to leave, because she loved him, and, you know, anything, if she'd stayed, you know, it couldn't have ever ended well for either one of them. And she sort of, the more she stayed and the more she realized what, you know, Crassus was doing, and the sort of, like, when she joined Spartacus' camp and she saw the realities of what slaves sort of go through, because she was a very privileged slave, I think she understood a lot more, and that's why she ended up doing what she did.
Okay. Okay, so Christian, is it Sabinus? Is that how you pronounce it? Sabinus? I don't know.
Sabinus.
That's crazy. Okay, so he said, what of your desires? Apollo himself would be set ablaze by them. As seeming simple conversation until his reply, I shall remember not to stand too near. And then you were suddenly, oh my God, don't leave me. And you reached out, locking your hand over his arm, and the look in your eyes reflecting a far deeper sense of concern and the possibility of losing a friend. Okay, so solutions that being quickly concealed by you both when your mom came. What was the true nature of your relationship? And how were you able to keep it?
I think it's something that the writers spoke about as well. It's something that they wanted to keep. They really wanted the answers to be in the hands of the audience and only the audience. They didn't want to portray anyone kind of way. But I think at the core of it, what that relationship was, I think it was a strong friendship, but more than that, it was a chance for two young men growing up to be vulnerable, to have vulnerable, intimate conversations about the life outside of this emperor and this world that they were living in, and this structure of power and authority that all of a sudden, you know, my mother wasn't someone that I could go to because she had to be the strong mother and the strong woman next to Crassus. Crassus, I sure as hell couldn't go to him and tell him that I'm upset or, you know, my heart is hurt for some reason, or I don't like what you've said to me. So I needed an outlet for that. And Sabinus was somebody who was there that I could, you know, seek affection within as a friend. And I think that that was really important. But I think also, for me, it was important to hide that, because any kind of vulnerability, because society doesn't really have an outlet for even today, for men to be vulnerable. Do you know what I mean? And that's why we have the privilege of doing that in the art, because we get to have that outlet, because all emotion is going to go somewhere. Do you know what I mean? And if men aren't open about emotion, just any emotion, it bottles up and turns into rage. That's just, you know, it's just how the brain works. So in order for me to be vulnerable, that would then have Crassus perceive that as weakness. And that wasn't something that I was willing to show my father, that I was weak. But it was healthy, and I needed an outlet for that. So he was there, and he was my best friend. And I think once you have those conversations with someone you can't have with another person, you form that bond that is kind of separate on its own to other relationships. So that's why it was so hard, because I had been so close, we had shared so much about what we were truly feeling. Because we both, at the end of the day, were hardened young soldiers who wanted to rule as well. We wanted to be at the top of the Roman Empire together, standing brothers in arms, so, you know, and to have that bond as well. So I think that was important. But yeah, it was definitely a challenge for Tiberius. And then after decimation, of course, the test that Crassus had given him, you know, I think all of a sudden he lost that ability to share and to be open with somebody else. So there comes the rage.
It's interesting to note, I don't know if you guys know this as well, they were in the Roman army, oh, probably armies, other armies as well, they were always encouraged to have a relationship potentially with some of their other soldiers that were in their platoons, to basically, it would be sexual, obviously, at times as well. It wasn't regarded as like what would be a homosexual relationship in our terms, but it was basically to build a physical and sexual and chemical bond with the person beside you, so that in battle you would fight even more fiercely in order to protect yourself and your brother. So quite often they would pair up people, or you become paired up, because you'd also be away for months at a time as well, and they'd have what would be kind of a soldier's relationship, and it was basically to encourage that, like, kind of protection element as well, so that when you're in battle, if I don't know Christian, I might not necessarily make the sacrifice that I would is if he was like seen as a brother to me. So then they would encourage that, so that they'd fight more fiercely and therefore more successful. I remember reading that and I was like, that's such a good idea, because when your heart's in it, you're gonna fight harder as if you don't know the person, but like, oh, you died. So
okay, so Todd, a very different Tiberius awaited you when you came back from Sinuessa. The rivalry between the two of you seemed to intensify. He looked at you at one point and said, "You are not at my side, you serve beneath me." These were haunting words from the mouth of a boy who soon proceeded with an unassuming attempt upon your life by freeing a gladiator's hands during a celebration in your honor. He pressed further advantage, ordering you held while he raped you. What kept you to silence in regard to
you could not speak about it.
Were you protecting your
side,
or were you afraid of his power?
I think that was, we discussed this just on that note, but not necessarily, I'll answer the question hopefully, but we discussed this element, and the key with that scene is that it was the ultimate stripping of power. You literally, I don't think there is anything else that a man could do another man, particularly in that era, that would strip the power the way that act does, particularly being held down as well. The power play emotionally, physically, sexually, spiritually, chemically, like every element you can possibly imagine, I think, gets stripped away. And that's why that scene was so important. We laugh about it, joke about it, but at the time, when the producers came to talk to us about it, I remember, I'll never forget the day, because I was just finished lunch and I was walking back to set, and the producer walked up and he goes, "I just want to have a chat with you." I was like, "Okay, this is usually not good if producers start." Or it's like, "You're doing a really good job." And I was like, "Okay, nervous." And he's like, "Okay, so just wanted to give you the heads up. You haven't read the script yet, but there's going to be a rape scene with you and Tiberius." And I just remember the first response was, I laughed at him because I thought he was joking. I was like, "Oh, that's good, that's funny. No, seriously, what's happening?" And he's like, "No, so we're going to do a rape sequence." And I was like, "Okay, cool." And then we sat down and talked about the justification of it, because it was the ultimate power play. And it was full on shooting that scene. You know, I'd been friends with Christian already, so we were sort of already comfortable, which was good. But, you know, people on set had to walk off. Because it was quite confronting, you know, having to go through it. And we shot that scene, so I'm just side notes, but this is, you know, give a bit of background. We shot that scene four times back to back too. So normally you shoot scenes in like a broken down sequence. You might shoot a section, then a section, then a section. The way that TJ shot that was, he shot it back to back. So from the start of the scene, when the guards walk in, they attack me, I grab him, do the fight sequence, then the rape happens. It was four times, we did it over and over. So he wanted to create that essence of basically being like physically destroyed, really. So by, they ended up using, I think, two or three of, like a couple of takes, but it was like the later takes, so that the exhaustion had set in. And the guys that I had to stop myself getting beaten from were MMA fighters too. So they were tough dudes. Like, they were ripping my hair and like smashing me into the table. Sorry, digress. Anyway, so the reason why that scene was good is it was a power play, and that was, we're in a different society back then, you have to remember. So we actually really embraced that scene. It was really important. It brought in the pride issue, sorry to link back, brought in the pride issue as well for Caesar. That's why he didn't want to bring it up, because obviously there'd be that element of embarrassment, you know what I mean? And he then wanted to get back his own, you know what I mean? I mean, admitting that to someone else would be full on, particularly back in that period, especially someone seen as, you know, like an insubordinate, oh sorry, insubordination in regards to the rank system as well. And, you know, that's the ultimate play against Caesar too, because of that pride element and his power. So, I don't know, I thought it was a really crucial moment. I thought it worked well in the show. Like, I could see why they played that in the end, even though it was confronting to do. I thought it created a whole new dynamic, and also a whole new intention and fire. Like, when I was remembering when I shot that stuff, afterwards all my scenes had a fury that was like I got to unleash that I hadn't really unleashed before, you know what I mean? Because that drove me. So yeah, I rattled on then, but you know, I hope that helped.
Okay, Jenna, kind of going back to what you said about how you always talk to Crassus, you tried to change his mind, you tried to, like, you were a second mother to Tiberius, perhaps more a father as well, providing him with compassion and guidance, which his parents were incapable of providing. You offered your opinions and solutions to him in this regard, he encouraged and he indulged you. But you must have known and must have seen he'd never be any different. And he said to you about Tiberius, he grows stronger each day to meet morning sun, or you said, he grows stronger each day beneath warming sun of father's guidance. That wasn't true. So what was your drive in this hopeless pursuit? What were you seeking? Were you like trying to waylay a guilt of your own for his attentions to you instead of his family? Or what exactly was it that drove you to continue to press him?
I'm a little bit confused.
Okay, I'm sorry. My question basically is, you kept trying to make him see like the error of his way.
Yeah, Crassus, yes.
Right,
yeah.
Exactly. But did you really feel that he would ever really listen to you? What was the reason? Did you ever feel like guilty that he gave you attentions that he didn't give to his son or to his wife?
No, I think, oh, that's interesting. I haven't thought about it. I don't think so, because I mean, it was, I don't think, I'm gonna sort of like go around a little bit. I don't think Corey never wanted to be Mrs. Crassus. She never wanted to marry Crassus. That was not in her wildest dreams anywhere she wanted to go. Like, that was just like, she was very much a product of her time, her structure. She was like, she was very happy where she was. She was very happy being a slave. She knew how lucky she was. She felt lucky to be chosen in a way by Crassus, and therefore it's that thing where, you know, as Christian and Todd have both said, they both looked up to this man as like, you know, as like an idol, you know, that type of thing. So his affection was not just, you know, so that was, you know, an amazing thing for her to have. I think, you know, to have his ear is also something that she didn't do anything for her own gain, I don't think. Like, even, you know, she, like, at the beginning, all of her advice, everything she did was for the benefit of those two men. I don't know how much his wife really factored. I think she felt awful, like, that situation, you know, that it was there, but I think that it was sort of like, that's the way things were. I don't think that Crassus's wife and her position, because she never wanted to be his wife, she just knew that would never happen. I don't think that she felt that she was ever a threat to Crassus's wife, and I don't think Crassus's wife ever felt that she was that Corey was a threat. That's just that. It wouldn't matter if they were both in love and they wanted to be, it was never gonna happen, so that's fine. I think that just the fact that the advice Corey would give to Crassus and to Tiberius and that was never for Corey's advantage. So I think Crassus knew that when she spoke, it would, like, it was, you know, just sort of her point of view. And she sort of, the way she phrased things, the way she put things to him was sort of like, this is where I think you should be going. And then, you know, he would sort of like take giant leaps from that point. But she never sort of went, do this, do that. She never did anything to sort of like be like, this is what, you know, you must do this. It was sort of like, he's awesome, like, he's growing up, look at him like a man. And then he'd be like, yes, I should look at him like a man, and therefore I'm going to do this, this, and this, you know, that type of thing. So it was never malicious. It was never to sort of like to gain advantage for herself. Yeah, is that where sort of I was? Now I'm like, where am I going with this? That was Corey's thing, is that the whole thing about Corey was that, and what got, like, even at the very end, like, she knew when she went back to Crassus, when, after she killed Tiberius, she knew what was going to happen. I mean, I'm sure, I don't know, there was obviously a conversation between her and Caesar, like, on the way back, like, going, so, you killed his son, yeah, well, he raped me, that sort of thing. Like, that obviously sort of happened, into the extent that, like, when they sort of planned to cover it up and all that sort of stuff, like the old man killed him, that was that story? Yeah. So that conversation obviously happened, so she thought maybe she might live, but I don't think, she didn't offer herself to go back thinking she was going to live. She was pretty aware of what was going to happen, yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Okay, so, I thought honor position was all but mine. Now I fear he favors another. Sent to send you message as spy upon Spartacus, Crassus made it clear you were not the attack, yet you chose disobedience over command. My father desires a wolf of battle, not a well-heeled dog, an obvious preference. What firmed your decision to pursue an attack? What did you hope to accomplish? What led you to believe that such disregard would elevate your worth in the eyes of your father, whose demands never wavered from that of total compliance?
I don't know, I think there just comes a point where you need to push the boundaries in order to realize exactly how far you can go and how much you can achieve. And when you're that age, and I think you're so hungry to have that honor and position, you have an opportunity in front of you and you can see, you know, I don't know, so I used to always stick back to the Lion King, because Simba, you've got everywhere that you could go except for the elephant graveyard. He goes into the elephant graveyard, and he becomes a fucking man. You know what I mean? I feel like that was the thing, and it was he was willing to. It's not that he was willing to face the consequences. I think his arrogance just literally didn't allow him to consider the concept of fate. I think he just genuinely thought 100% that he was going to commit, and that he was going to win, and that failure and retreat was not going to be an option.
I thought you would have. I would have done the same thing though. That's the funny thing. Like, you didn't get a chance to explain to Crassus what the situation was, but when I was watching it as an audience member, I'm like, here you go, Mark. Like, you're outnumbering him. Like, you would never expect that that would be the outcome. Yeah, anyway, so I'm just backing up.
So, I mean, if I was on the hill with Sabinus and then Sabinus had said, don't, your father told you to stay command, and then he went, yeah, you're right, let's go home. I don't think that would have, you know, served very well, but they're the moments that define you. And
go on.
And the outcome, if you did kill him, you would be Lord. Like, it was either fail or be Lord, because you would have killed Spartacus and ended everything. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. So it was like, I think it was worth the risk.
Exactly. And I think, I don't know, Crassus was so intelligent. Historically, if you look at the way that he controlled Rome and the surrounding regions around that time, he was so intelligent that I feel like him sending his son out on a mission, he knew he was either going to succeed or he was going to fail and learn and become even stronger and then succeed. So I think he knew that sending him out there anyway, if he makes a mistake, he's going to be angry, but in hindsight, he would have taught him a more significant and more valuable lesson. And I think that's a hard thing to do, you know? Let's go back to the Lion King. It's like Mufasa telling him to go to the elephant graveyard, you know what I mean? But that's where, who knows, I'm not a parent, so I don't know how that dynamic works, but I'm sure it would be difficult because you'd want your child to learn and grow through adversity and through experience, but at the same time, you've got to protect them. But the only way to grow, I think, is through the adversity. That's what I'm finding now in my life anyway, and a lot of people can relate that I've been speaking to. So it's so incredible how the challenges are the things that define you. And you've got to change the concept of what you think failure is. And I think that's what Tiberius has learned. Because everything up until you killed me, they were the things that defined me. They were the things, you know, everything that defined me and made me grow, you know, weren't the little successes, they were all the little failures that led to that. And I think that's, you know, credit to the writers as well, they knew what they were doing.
Okay. Okay, I have a theory. I have to throw this at you, Caesar. I know, right? That can be brutal. Okay, so kind of hitting on the conversation that you guys had with regard to your leaving, Caesar helping. Okay, so yeah, it's one of my long questions. Fall asleep if you want. So rather than sending Tiberius to Pompey, as you had been ordered, you sent him into the hands of the enemy. Knowing Cora was there, a look of utter dismay, terror, you were like, oh my God, what are you doing kind of thing, etched your countenance when she attacked Tiberius. Yet her murderous act did not seem an impulsive decision, but more like a well-planned assassination, in that she was armed with a weapon. Considering your successful infiltration and ruse as Lysistus and Sinuessa, Caesar the mastermind, the boy who would be a man, were you using Cori to get rid of Tiberius? Were you clearing the path for your rise as Crassus' word and his will? What was your intention?
That was less comfortable. I was scared because I was like, you're going to bring up something that I don't remember. No, it was the decision that I made as an actor as well. And I had to ask that question too, because funnily enough that you say that, on the day that we were shooting it, I remember the director gave me a note to act. They wanted me to be more shocked at the fact that there was an assault happening and the fact that they wanted the emphasis, they wanted a close-up shot of my reaction to shit, Corey's coming for him, we've got to stop it. Basically, my approach for that was that he wanted the vengeance himself, 100%. Like, it was all, again, a plot to bring him back so that I could take him out. Because that that's the ultimate satisfaction. Obviously, he degraded me to the highest degree, so it was my, that was my opportunity to come back at him and just do some real bad shit. So I never planned that it was Corey's, like that I was sort of working together with her. We're in sort of some sort of agreement. I feel like he definitely had empathy for Corey. I always felt like that was a great dynamic to have in the script because it showed another side of Cities. Obviously, he has that moment with the slave girl as well, where you just get a little private moment to go, all right, this is my chance to show some humanity and some compassion in him. And then we got that with Corey as well, because I think her actions were justified as well. You know, again, you have to make your decisions to justify your actions, so it makes sense at the end. But yeah, for me, it was, he was going to get his own. He was going to come back and he was going to take him out himself. Yeah. Is that it?
Yeah, that is.
Yeah, cool.
Okay, so Jenna, you kind of touched on this already, but you said, I stand no soldier in this conflict, yet I too shall do my must. You followed your heart and joined the rebellion and sent your attacker to Hades. What made you go back to Crassus? Was it a sacrificial act which seemed more a suicidal gesture? He kissed you with tears in his eyes, following which he proclaimed, from this day forth you shall address me as Roman. What were your final thoughts as you looked down from the cross, Caesar and Crassus both watching you? How was your sacrifice worth the price that you paid him?
I think it would have been pretty tough for her to continue in his house with him knowing what had happened and all of that sort of stuff, and knowing what what Tiberius had done and what Corey had done. Like, it was not possible. So I see that her sacrifice was sort of like probably the only, like, Corey. She loved Tiberius. Like, she didn't want to have, like, none of this. She didn't want any of this stuff to happen. She didn't sort of, like, in a way, it's like, I feel like Corey was almost a construct to show what, you know, you have Crassus and you have Tiberius, and they're all about their power and vengeance and this and that. And then Corey is like this, almost this pawn who is just like, she's the one that sort of like, she's just like, you know, she loves them both, and she is just, you know, she just gets completely screwed over, and it's that way of, it's almost like, you know, I was just thinking about it a second ago, where it's like, she's, for the audience, it's like, she's, like, how do I say this? She's sort of like, she's an example of, you know, the sort of like the casualties of war, if you know what I mean? Like, absolutely, and she's sort of like, she's the fallout of their relationship. It's like, you know, and she did everything for them, and I don't think she could live with herself, really, after having done everything that we've gone through it, and having gone through all that and then done that stuff. I think, you know, you could see in that scene where she wants to tell Crassus when she comes back. Everything that's on her, like, she wants to tell Crassus what happened beforehand, which is why she has to leave, because she knows that telling Crassus what Tiberius did he's gonna either, you know, there's two options. He's either gonna want to kill his son, which she doesn't want to happen, or he's going to not want to kill his son, which she doesn't want to happen, you know? So it's that thing where she goes, well, okay, I can't be in this. I have to sort of get out of that. And I think that, yeah, so there was sort of like, people say to me, oh, he could have sold you off. And I'm like, yeah, no, but she wouldn't have been able to live with herself, I don't think. So I think in the end, like, she knew that would have had to be, you know, he could have done it a bit less painful. There are nice ways, but, you know, yeah, I think that was, yeah.
Okay. Okay, Christian, would that I had drawn the stone in Sabina's place, would the world not still turn without me? What brought such words to your lips? Self-blame, self-loathing, or was it something more? A deeper wound removed from sight. Having seen all you'd strive to accomplish destroyed by your desperate longing to live up to your father's expectations, you struck out with impulsive brutality, projecting your rage. I am what you have made me. What was that example?
I think in the moment of decimation, he realized that all this pursuit of this power and everything, at the end of the day, that you know, just having a connection with someone and family and love and friendship and honesty, they're the things that are most important, and power and all that shit doesn't mean anything. I think he realized in that moment, and he had led Sabinus into that trap by being so ruthless and relentless in wanting the power, that he said, you know, Sabinus, stand by me, you know, let's do this together. So he dragged him into the belly of the beast, and now all of a sudden Sabinus is the one who's turned the stone. So it's almost, he sees in that moment what's real and what's not, and you know, he wishes that he could have traded places. And yeah, like I was saying, you can say one thing, but it's what you do that others are going to emulate. So Crassus was that authoritative figure that shut off his ability to be emotive and to be caring in a loving sense to his son. And he trained a soldier, but he trained like a Roman robot before that. So all of a sudden he's, you know, I am what you have made me, you know, I'm, you know, his son Tiberius literally became a walking sword. Do you know what I mean? Just a silver sword, and that was it, and there was nothing else to it. And then, you know, as the season progressed, he started to, you know, go through experiences that opened him up and shaped him differently. But yeah, I am what you have made me. It's you know, I am your product. This is what you are, and this, you know, it's a direct connection.
Just to touch on that as well, to give some credit to Christian. I don't know about you guys, I love the fact that at the start his innocence was there. And when they stripped that away, he was never dark. Like, he was dark the whole time. Like, those first few episodes, I was like, oh, cool, yeah, I see where this is going. And then once that innocence got stripped away and that man came out and that beast came out, even his head was never high again. It was always tilted down. If you take note of choices that Christian made as an actor, I love that. I just love watching that back as an audience member. You don't really see it as an actor when you're in it because you're so absorbed with every element, and then you watch it back. I love that, bro, how you just transitioned that and had that. Yeah, good, nice. That's great. It relates to that moment. You know, he lost his instincts. He learned that there was, that vulnerability led to the destruction of his closest relationship, so screw vulnerability, and he hardened in that moment and then just became like this dark warrior. I just love that. It was cool.
It was cool. All right, last question for you. All right, so we shall meet again upon a day. Words broke in an ominous portent. That day came and found you face to face with Ganicus. You stood watching with a smile as your men set upon him, waiting until he was disarmed on his knees. Before approaching him yourself, laughter dancing in your eyes and laughter dancing from your lips and conquest in your eyes, you struck him with a final blow. But what victory was that, Max? It was not you.
Power play again. It's all about the power play. I actually, it wasn't until we started shooting that scene that I made the decision to enjoy that moment, because we blocked it out and he goes down, blah blah blah. I walk into the circle. You don't really have any intention behind it because you're just kind of playing the scene. Just doing the block, it's called blocking. You block the scene out physically where you're gonna be, but you don't necessarily have your intention, your performance, you're just blocking it out. And I remember distinctly, like, they yelled action and we played that, and I was like, I'm not gonna lie, it's the first time I watched that scene back and I'm like, you're a dick. And all the other scenes was like, yeah, no, I get an intention, but he was just being a dick. It was just a power play. Honestly, seriously, I'll take that. Because it was like, he was in such a dismissive position. And I had so much power around me, surround me with my army, physically, you know, and emotionally. So that was just my moment, and to soak it up too. And I took more time with it. And I remember again, I took more time with it before I hit him in the face, and I looked at him and then wound the butt up. And I remember the director was like, I love that you took time there. Do it again. Let's take that time again. I was like, cool. Because it was for me to come in and just, for both of us to have that moment of like, I've got you, bro, like, I've got you. You know what I mean? And to own that moment, because again, there was also a disappointing part of that because we had done a massive Gannicus fight, and it was about, like, every sword hit is called a beat. And we'd done like a 75 beat fight, which is huge. And then on the day, they had to strip it down to about 35, 30 beats. So originally that battle that I had one-on-one with Gannicus was huge. We like disarm each other. I like punch him in the face. He knees me in the head. He disarms me. I get my sword back. I grab his two swords and I'm double for wielding it and knocks his sword out. It was huge. So anyway, that kind of paid homage to that moment because it was like we had that one-on-one, which I feel like I would have beaten him anyway. But then, that's what it was for me. It was just to own that moment of like, I've got you. It was a sucker moment, but you know, he was just gonna take it and own it because I just like that darkness. That's why I love Caesar, because he has that darkness. You know what I mean? And not necessarily honorable, but it's dark and it's interesting. And I just kind of like to play that moment, you know, just draw it out.
Well, thank you all so very much.
Very much. Thank you guys. And also, I think next time,
I'll come back for session two. It's all yours. I'll shut up. The floor is yours. I'll hand the mic. And you can ask all the questions you'd like. So I'll see you tomorrow evening.
Thank you guys. Thanks, guys.